I try to picture a girl through a looking glass and see her as a carbon atom. See her eyes and stare back at them. See the girl as her own new world. Though her home is on the surface, she is still a universe. Glory God, oh God is peeking through the blinds. Are we all here standing naked, taking guesses at the actual date and time? Oh my, justifying reasons why is an absolutely insane resolution to live by. Live high, live mighty, live righteously. Taking it easy, live high, live mighty, live righteously. Taking it easy, live high, live mighty, live righteously. Let's take it easy.
My name is Munira Premji. I'm 54 years old, and in 2012 of February, I was diagnosed with two cancers. You know, I remember the exact moment. It was February 3rd of 2012 at 4:08 p.m. Dr. Wu from Toronto General Hospital came into my hospital bed and told Naguib, my husband, and myself that tests showed that I had stage 3 multiple myeloma. And we just looked at him in complete disbelief, complete shock. We had expected perhaps that I may have anemia, but cancer? Cancer? Like, where did that come from? We were overwhelmed, we were shocked, we were just totally floored. And I remember the first question I asked Dr. Wu was, how long do I have to live? And his answer was variable. You know, what does variable mean? You know, in my mind, I'd already decided that I had, you know, 2 weeks to live, and that was it. Naguib and I just held each other tight, wouldn't let go of each other. We just didn't know how to continue. You know, what happened to our dreams of living together happily ever after? How do we tell our children? I mean, what does life look like after this? And between tears and heartbreak, we just held on to each other and took comfort in that. And then I became this frantic machine. I mean, I thought I had 2 weeks to live, and I remembered that our house needed hardwood floors. And, you know, I just started making phone calls, like random phone calls, because I wanted these hardwood floors done. And 3 days after my diagnosis, our house had hardwood floors. But things were going to get worse, so much worse. I was back at work, and Dr. Jean Wang, our hematologist, phoned me at work to say that my bone marrow was doing some funny stuff, and I needed to come back for more tests. And those further tests revealed that I had a very aggressive moving stage 4 non-Hodgkin lymphoma. Dr. Wang referred me to an oncologist by the name of Dr. Tiedemann, who had expertise in both myeloma and lymphoma. And when he looked at my situation, he said, you know, we've got to put the myeloma on hold, and we've got to really focus on getting rid of the lymphoma, otherwise you're just not going to make it. Basically, the treatment for the lymphoma was very invasive chemotherapy called R-CHOP. And I went through this chemotherapy every 3 weeks for a full day. And, you know, this continued for 4 months. And I got to tell you, it was not an easy experience. During that time, I got so many infections, and I just ended up going to the hospital with febrile neutropenia, which really means high fever. And I would end up staying in the hospital for many days. But you know, through all of that, God was right there looking after me. And 4 months later, I was able to overcome the lymphoma and was declared by Dr. Tiedemann, you know, said that the lymphoma was now in remission. One of the times that I remember most vividly about this experience was when I was in emergency one time, and the doctors in emergency had pretty much given up on me, and they had prepared me and my family to the fact that I might not make it. My hemoglobin count was very, very low at 36. My family and I were sitting together praying, and I remember looking at each one of them and thinking, this is the absolute last time that I'm going to ever pray with them. And I remember wishing them each really well through their lives, and then ended up in intensive care for a couple of days. But again, you know, God basically looked after me, and I remember dreaming that He said, you know, I got this one. I got this one. You'll be fine. So with the treatment of lymphoma done, we went to Florida for a week of vacation, came back, and in July we started treatment for the multiple myeloma. The treatment for multiple myeloma was so different. One of the things was, you know, a different kind of chemo, which was once a week, every week, for a period of time. Myeloma is a pesky disease. You know, there is no cure for it at this point. My oncologist recommended that I have a stem cell transplant, which I did in February of this year. And that was a very interesting process. We had to go with harvesting my own stem cells, collecting them, and then freezing them until it was ready for transplant time. So the transplant happened about 3 months ago. And what the transplant does is it keeps the cancer away for about 2 years. And then it's time for another transplant. So my hope right now is, you know, I'm at a place where my lymphoma is in remission, my myeloma is sort of at bay, and my hope is that we're able to find a cure for the myeloma during my lifetime.
There's your stem cells back.
Cancer is a tough battle, and there are so many losses that come with it. For me, perhaps the biggest loss was that loss of purpose. You know, I love my work. I was one of those folks that would wake up early every morning just raving to go, you know, to work and start the day. And all of a sudden with cancer, you know, there was no place to go. And I just found that incredibly difficult to deal with. There was a loss of identity. You know, all of a sudden I saw myself as a cancer patient. I saw myself as a number, sometimes as a victim. And it just wasn't a fun place to be at all. I remember one time when, you know, through the process, I lost my hair and I lost my eyebrows. And I just woken up from bed and I went to the mirror, to brushing my teeth. And I looked at myself in the mirror and I went, ah! I just screamed so loud because I could not recognize the person that was looking right back at me. I looked like a complete and absolute freak. And I remember just running back to bed and just crying for the rest of the day. So the loss of identity was a really tough one. Then there was the loss of physical independence. You know, I've always been a really independent person. And all of a sudden, I needed help with, you know, the littlest things. I needed help with climbing the stairs. For the longest time, I needed help with taking a bath. I needed help, and I still need help when I'm sitting down to stand up. The chemo really does do its number, and it made me very, very weak. Then there was a loss of financial independence, which really had an impact on me. I was used to making good money and spending money, and all of a sudden, you know, I suddenly had to think about every purchase that I was making because suddenly there was no money coming in. And I think the other thing that I found really difficult is there was a loss of self-confidence. You know, I found that I was always sort of slumped, and I just felt, you know, less than, and I felt not good enough. And it really took a beating, you know, my self-confidence. And, you know, through that time, I was also going through a whole bunch of different stages of grief, you know. I went from, you know, being completely in denial. You know, I refused to accept that I had cancer. I was emotionally numb. Then I went through this period of being so angry, you know. I was just so angry and irritable and didn't want to be around anybody. Then I went through this stage of being quite depressed and wanting to withdraw and feeling really isolated, you know. And then it was really interesting. I came to a place of acceptance, and my acceptance did not come from writing, you know, long journals or sitting in quiet contemplation. It happened really when Carlos came home to clean the vents in the house. Carlos is a friend of mine, and you know, when he was cleaning the vents, I was in my room just sobbing my little heart out. And Carlos came to see if I was okay. And for 4 hours we talked. We talked about God, and we talked about faith, and we talked about life, and we talked about movies, and we talked about purpose, and we talked about a whole bunch of stuff. And to be really honest, I still don't remember to today what it is that he said. But he said something that just got me to a place where when he left our home, I felt such a peace, such a sense of peace, such a sense of acceptance. And it was right there in that moment that I just made this decision that I wasn't just going to accept cancer. I was going to embrace it, and I was going to have fun with it, and I was going to enjoy it as much as it was possible. And I remember taking this little journal of mine and writing down and making a list of all the things that I wanted to accomplish in life that I never really had time to do. I took that year and I just started to do all of the things that I wanted to do. And you know, it was the weirdest thing, but what I can say now is that cancer gave my life a whole new beginning.
Oh.
Every year we go to the cemetery and we remember family members who've passed away. And we spend a lot of time at that cemetery, walking row by row, reading the tombstones, contemplating about the lives of the people who are no longer with us. And that got me thinking, what if our lives had an expiry date, kind of like milk does? And this is something that I've had to confront in my own situation. You know, more specifically, what if we only had 2 or 3 years to live? How might we live our lives? And through this, I'm asking myself a lot of questions. I'm asking questions like, what do I want my legacy to be? What do I want my children to remember me for? What are the challenges that I want to confront? What are the areas that I want to focus on? What matters to me? What do I want to accomplish? Based on this, I've made a lot of changes in my life. What I've come to realize is that there are only a few things that are truly, truly, truly important to me in life. Family, close friends, faith, a sense of community, health and well-being, of course, an opportunity to contribute meaningfully in the world. Everything else I see now as just noise, just plain noise. And I have to say, now that I go back and I think about my life pre-cancer, I spent a lot of my time in that noise, you know, in the churning of just daily life, noise, noise, noise. Now I'm doing things differently. I started to create a bucket list to think about what I wanted to accomplish. And some are really, you know, far out there, but I've decided that, you know, it's like what Thomas Edison said, and he said something like, if we did all of the things that we were capable of doing, we would astound ourselves. And that's what I plan to do. I plan to totally astound myself. I've made some progress in the past year. I wanted to learn to cook, and now I'm really cooking up a storm. I never learned to swim, and I'm getting pretty good at swimming. Wanted to go to the Yankee Stadium to watch the Blue Jays play the Yankees, and we did that a month ago, Nagib and I. I've put together a first draft of my book, and hopefully I've redefined the way that people think about cancer and cancer patients. So I still have a very long way to go and a lot of things to accomplish, but I have to say that what I'm loving now is that I'm consciously designing my life and figuring out how I want to live, because I do believe that the best is yet to come. When I was diagnosed with cancer, my father-in-law once said to me, you have cancer, but cancer does not have you. You know, I've thought about that a lot. You have cancer, but cancer does not have you. And I just love this statement. I love this statement because yes, I am a person with cancer, but cancer does not need to define who I am. And so I started to change the dance. I started sitting, you know, taller. I started standing taller. I started getting out of the house. I started making dates with friends, you know, for coffee. And I started to live a life as normal as I possibly could. And it wasn't always easy because I wasn't always well. But I found that by doing this, I always felt better after the fact. You know, at the hospital, for instance, when my buzzer would go bzzz, you know, and it was time for chemotherapy, I would always kind of go, woohoo, chemo. And very slowly I became known in the chemo ward as the woohoo girl. And one of the rituals, and I have no idea how this ritual ever came about, but one of the rituals was I would take my iPad with me, and then, you know, my daughter and I would start to sing aloud, you know, while we were getting chemo treatments and bone strengthening treatments. We would sing Jersey Boy songs, you know, everyone. Our favorite one was, "You're just too good to be true, can't get my eyes off of you." And very slowly, we started to get other chemo patients to sing with us. And so I treated every visit to the hospital as a social event. And I so looked forward to getting to know people there. I got to know the receptionists, and I got to know the cleaners and the cancer cab drivers and the nurses. And my favorite part, though, was getting to know the patients. Because each patient was extraordinary. Each patient was incredible, and they all had stories to share. One patient that really had a huge impact on me was someone I met really quite by accident. We were sitting together listening to the jazz festival at the Princess Margaret Hospital in the atrium. And we got talking for almost an hour and a half. And I found out that he had a pretty severe form of stomach cancer, and he was not really expected to make it beyond a few months. And during that time, it was really incredible how he kept cheering me on and telling me how I was going to make this. He gave me a metaphor. He says, "You know, I visualize you in this boxing ring with you and cancer." And he says, "I gotta tell you, cancer has no chance against you, you know?" And we talked about making it through these difficult times, and we promised each other that we would not only make it through, but we would throw this huge party for everyone in the world once we made it through cancer. You know, other people that I've met, I mean, I met a woman who had lung cancer. And this is a woman with three young children. She was in her 30s. And this is a woman who for 2 years was looking for a lung in order to recover. And there was no lung available to her. And every day she was losing hope. I really don't know what's happened of her. But what I can tell you is that this woman had never smoked once in her lifetime. You know, last week I was in the hospital and I met another lady who had breast cancer 20 years ago. This lady teaches logic at the University of Toronto in the philosophy department. And she's this really elegant, elegant woman that just I couldn't stop staring at. And something's happened and she certainly needs additional treatment now. You know, I've met this unbelievable woman who I used to look forward to seeing at every hospital visit. She had breast cancer 5 years ago. And at the time that she was going through treatment, she was pregnant and didn't know it. So she went through all of the chemotherapy treatments, etc., while she was pregnant. And her baby is now 5 years old. And unfortunately, her cancer has now spread, and so she needs more treatment. You know, it occurred to me, you know, as I watch all these patients, that we tend to label people and we tend to, you know, think of people in terms of, you know, this is a cancer patient, this is a businessman, you know, this is a homemaker. And so often we limit people to the labels we give them. And yet what I'm learning is that every individual, you know, is a complex human being with dreams and challenges and hopes and passion. And I find now that when I'm meeting people for the first time or even for the 100th time, I'm always so curious about them. It's as if I'm meeting them for the first time, you know. No labels, only people. You know, a crazy funny thing happened to me when I went to Old Navy once. So I took in about 20, you know, sets of clothes, and I had an attendant standing outside, and I said to her, you know, I'm going to try them, I'm going to come out, and you're going to take a look and tell me whether I should buy or not. I go to the dressing room, I try on an outfit, I come out, and the attendant either gives me the thumbs up or the thumbs down, you know. And so we've got this great partnership happening. And then all of a sudden, when I was trying on my eighth or my ninth outfit, I came out again and I said, so what do you think of this dress? And she looked at me and she went, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And I thought she was gonna have a heart attack. I didn't even know what was going on. And she kept looking at me and she hung on to the pole beside her and she pointed it at my head and she was going, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And I didn't know what was going on, and I went into the room and I looked, and what had happened is my hair had totally fallen off. My wig had fallen off my head. And I just burst out laughing. I looked so funny. She burst out laughing. And for the next 10 minutes, all we did was laugh and laugh and laugh because it was just one of those crazy, crazy, crazy moments. Sorry. Anyway, so one of the things that I have tried to do in my journey with cancer is have fun with it. And part of that is trying on different looks, different wigs. And I want to show you some of these wigs. So this one is my blonde look. I love this look. I feel really pretty when I wear this wig. And I have to tell you now from experience that blondes really do have more fun. This wig is my professional look. It's the wig that I will likely wear when I go for a job interview. So this is a look that I'm hoping to emulate once I get my real hair back. This one is my most wild wig. When I first saw this, I wasn't sure that I wanted to buy it, but my hairdresser convinced me that I would find uses for this wig, and I have. I tend to wear this wig when I'm feeling really fun and really feisty. So I have a story about this wig. This is a newer collection. I picked this up perhaps a couple of months ago. So I went to the airport to pick my daughter up, who was arriving from Africa, and I had this wig on, and she hadn't seen me in this, and she had the nerve to walk right past me because she didn't recognize who I looked like. So we call this my Beyoncé wig. So this wig is one that I kind of wanted because it's got bangs on it. So the last time I had bangs was when I was like 13 years old, so this just takes me back. You know, for me, the best part about having all these different looks is the reaction of my husband when he comes home. He just never knows what woman he's going to come home to. What I want to show you now is my most favorite look, and that look is this look. This is my bold, beautiful look. For so long during my journey with cancer, I hid behind scarves, I hid behind wigs. I was just too embarrassed to come out and show who I was. But at some point, I got comfortable with my own skin. And now I'm having so much fun with it. You'll notice I have something called a henna crown on my head. This is a service provided by a company called Henna Heals. They have a mission of making people who've lost hair feel more beautiful. And I gotta tell you, I feel so beautiful when I'm sporting a henna crown. This is who I am, world. This is Munira. This is me. Something significant happened to me a few weeks ago, something that's made me stronger. A game changer, really. It was when I was coaching a friend, and I heard her talk about what was not going well in her life. You know, this was not working, that was not working, this was not something she was happy about, not. And as I was listening to her, I kept challenging her to think about how she wanted her life to be more future-focused, to really think about the outcomes that she wanted, as opposed to being focused on what was not working. And, you know, and then it kind of hit me, you know, that, my goodness, I should be doing the same. You know, rather than focusing on my cancer, maybe I should be turning my focus on living fully, you know, living with vitality. And by doing this, I found that I was totally redefining my relationship with cancer. Yes, I have to go for chemo every week, and yes, I have bad days, and yes, I understand the reality of my situation, and yes, I know that one of my cancers is incurable, but I don't focus on any of that. I let it go. I understand what needs to be done. I do it without complaints, I manage my life, but where I really focus on are the things that I want to accomplish in the future. And by doing that, what I've found is that the cancer has become such a very, very small part of my life. The truth is, most times I even forget that I have cancer. I don't even think about it. It's just one of those things that I have to do and move on. The rest of the time, I really look at the future. And I've found that my life has become so much more abundant. I'm now living in a place of possibilities. And I've come to realize that it's not just about the challenges that we have, because each one of us, you know, regardless of our lot in life, we all have challenges we're dealing with. You know, they could be health challenges or work challenges or relationship challenges. You know, that's okay. But if we choose to just focus on what we want the outcome to be, if we just choose to focus on what is important to us, I have found that that's when extraordinary things happen. And life becomes really quite magical. So, game changer, choose what you focus on. Before I went through the stem cell transplant process, I had to go through so many tests to make sure I was ready for the transplant. Tests for the heart, tests for the kidney, tests for the lungs. I even had to have my teeth and mouth tested to make sure that everything was in order. Then I had to prepare for the stem cell process, and that was, you know, having Neupogen injections being put into my stomach. I had to have a Hickman line inserted surgically into my chest. I was at the hospital pretty much every day, and it was pretty darn overwhelming. On one of those overwhelming days, I was back at the hospital for chemo when I saw my very favorite nurse, Manny. As soon as Manny saw me, he opened up his arms wide like this, and he gave me a giant, giant bear hug. He told me how excited he was that I was going through the stem cell transplant. He told me that I should feel so good because not everybody was deemed ready to go for stem cells. He told me that today was the first day of the rest of my life. And the whole time I'm looking at Manny and I'm going, huh? Okay then, change of paradigm. Manny gave me a beautiful bracelet which said, "Once you choose hope, anything is possible." I wear this bracelet a lot, and I see the truth of that statement every day. You know, as we go through challenges in life, we find different ways of dealing with those challenges. And for me, regardless of the challenges that life throws at us, regardless of the curveballs we get, I think hope is a necessary ingredient. When there is hope, even a glimmer of it, there's ways to find answers to problems. When there is hope, there is a sense of optimism and of resourcefulness. What I've learned is that no matter how difficult a situation is, the question that I'm always asking myself is, what is hopeful in that situation? You know, what is good about the situation? What can I learn from the situation? And I find that more times than not, something comes up that's very positive. So for me, I've learned that once I choose hope, anything is possible and the universe is open to you. Sometimes when I think about my life with cancer, I worry. I worry about the future, I worry about the family, I worry if I'm going to make it. I worry that I may not see my daughter graduate. I worry that I may not see my son getting married. I worry that I may never get to see or hold my grandchildren in my arms. And I know that there is currently no cure for myeloma and the odds are against me. But there's a bumper sticker that changed all of this for me. It was in Florida when we saw this big bus with this big sign, and the sign said, "Relax, God's in charge." And I remember being so delighted by this sign because it was as if God was sending me a personal message, and that message was, quit worrying, I got this one. Just go about, do your business, I'm in charge. And it gave me a vision of this really smiling God who was always around me, you know, to be there to protect me. It was a nice feeling, peaceful feeling. I think as human beings, we all need a certain amount of control in our lives. And when life throws us a curveball or two curveballs, like in my case, sometimes it can feel like things are just going out of control in a dizzying pace. And yet, in the midst of all of that, what I've come to realize is that I still have so much influence over my life. I can choose how I'm going to respond to the cancer. I can be thankful that my lymphoma is now in remission. I can be optimistic that there are so many wonderful cures and treatments for the multiple myeloma. I can visualize all the yucky bad cells in my body being beaten in battle by all the good cells in my body that are flourishing. So there's a lot I have control over. What I have found really helpful is a ritual that I have every night with God. It's a 15-minute date that I have when I go to bed every night. I speak to God about four different things. I talk to God about things I'm grateful for that day. I talk to Him about people who are in my thoughts. I share with God all the magical things that have happened to me during the day. And I then share with Him all the problems that I have that I need help with. And once I do that, it's amazing. I'm just able to like close my eyes and go right to sleep. The way I see it is we are in a partnership with God. We cannot let Him do all the work. We need to do our part. And I think our part is knowing that God knows what it is that He is doing. It is human nature, I think, to worry. But it's also a liberating feeling to know that God is the planner. He is the master architect. He's the choreographer. He's the director. And He is the producer. So I'm totally relaxed because I can be. And I can be because God's in charge. Thank you.
this dies. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you.
When we went to Florida 11 years ago, our suitcase was filled to the brim with some really cool stuff. We had toys and Ninja Turtle gear. We had frisbees and baseball gloves. And it was a magical, wonderful time where we spent so many hours on the beach building sandcastles and making dreams. Our kids are older now. And our suitcase, when we went back to Florida last year, looked really quite different. As I opened up the suitcase, I mean, there was medicine that the doctors had insisted that I take with me, heparin injections and gauzes and other medicine just in case I got sick. The nurse had come home before we went on vacation to teach Naguib how to change my pick line. And so we had all of the equipment, you know, for changing of my pick line every 2 days so that my pick line would remain open for chemotherapy and blood transfusion treatments when I got back. I started to think about the suitcase as a metaphor for life. What is in our personal suitcase? What do we put in it? Do we think about what we have in our suitcase? You know, is it overflowing with things that make us joyful? Is it overflowing with a lot of baggage from many, many, many years past? You know, so many times we carry things in our suitcase that we may not need. Do we have things that we carry just because we are afraid that we need to have everything with us in our lives? How much baggage do we truly carry? A couple of years ago, I read a book called The Adversity Advantage, a book written by Paul Stolz and Eric Weinheimer, an incredible gentleman who has climbed the summit of all of the largest mountains around the world, including Mount Everest. And what makes this story truly compelling for me is that Eric Weinheimer is blind. And one of the concepts that he talks about is the concept of pack right, pack light. And he talks about how you need to carry just enough things to be able to get to the mountain comfortably without being weighed down. At different stages in our lives, we may need to pack and unpack what's in our suitcase. We may need different things in our suitcase. But the idea is to always be very conscious about what it is that we're packing in our suitcases and leaving the baggage behind. So my question to you is, what's in your suitcase?
That's why today I take life as it comes.
When you have cancer, it is sometimes difficult to find anything to be grateful about. Between the fatigue, the nausea, the vomiting, the tiredness, the mouth sores, you know, it sometimes can feel like the entire world is conspiring against you. But I've learned that when I choose to stay in the space of gratitude, something incredible happens. I wake up each morning feeling so grateful for the opportunity to be alive, and I end each day taking stock of all of the wonderful blessings that I find all around me. And I find that when I start to look for things to be grateful for, there are at least three things, if not 20, that I'm able to list off right away every day of my life. And that is something that I am truly grateful for. One of the things that I have a real sense of gratitude for is the wonderful words of wisdom that I've received from so many people around the world. Words to inspire me, words to motivate me, words that make me laugh, words that make me cry, words that make me feel. And in the past year and a half, I've received so many emails from so many people around the world. Emails from kids that I taught when they were in grade 6 and grade 7 who are now fathers. Emails from someone that I knew at kindergarten and had lost touch with. Emails from family that I didn't even know I had. And it's really makes me feel that I'm sitting in a place of gratitude that so many people have taken time to share their wisdom, their collective wisdom with me, and I'm all the more richer for it. I've actually taken all of these wonderful emails and I've put them in a scrapbook that I read so often throughout the day, and I have to tell you that these words of wisdom, these wonderful prayers have really helped me immensely through my journey with cancer. Early in my journey, somebody sent me a quote that has really stuck with me up until today. It said that the will of God does not take you where the grace of God does not protect you. I mean, think about it. The will of God does not take you where the grace of God does not protect you. And no matter how difficult my situation is, that quote is my true north. It's my rock. It's what I say over and over again. And I just see the value of just the incredible wisdom in that thought. The will of God does not take you where the grace of God does not protect you. Another quote that I received from a cancer survivor is one that I read very often. He said to me, you know, I want you to think about all of the things that you have left to do in the next 40 plus years, because what you're going through now is just a very, very small speed bump in the road of life, and it'll pass and you will win it. So don't even worry about that for now. Just manage through it, because you've got the next 40 plus years to really celebrate life. The funny thing is that the more I live in the space of gratitude, the more grateful I feel. It's almost like there is this multiplication effect, and it's a place of plentiness, and it's a place of abundance, and it's a place of wonder. And so it's a place that I choose to live in. And I must say that the one area that I am most grateful for every day is the opportunity to live, and the privilege of living every day is one that I'm most grateful for. Since my diagnosis with cancer, it has become a Premji tradition to propose a toast with every drink that we have. You know, whether it's morning tea or whether it's a coffee from Tim Hortons or a mango smoothie, we raise our glass and we always say the same toast. And the toast is to life, because for us that represents that magical moment in time where we celebrate being alive. And one day at Clearwater Beach, my daughter proposed a toast to life while we were sitting at the beach with the sounds of the ocean all about us and wonderful sunshine. And this is what her toast sounded like. Here's to the certainty of the sun rising every day and the stars shining every night. To surprises, unexpected delights, and all of the joys that come our way. to treading confidently in the direction of our dreams, to living each experience,
to being present, to first dates, play dates, and everything in between, to laughing until your stomach hurts, to exclamation marks, to freedom, to choice, to being the hero of your own story, to unexpected curveballs and roadblocks with a bag of lessons to be learned, to time, every second, every moment of it. Here's to first sips and last bites, to the beauty of our dreams and the magic of making them come true, to love, the greatest of all forces, and to holding on to it once we've been lucky enough to find it. To family, to friends who find their way into our hearts. To a world of opportunity and living in the world of possibilities. To hope and the courage and faith to know that everything will be all right. To the gift of living, to each breath, for this is what life is made of, to life.
I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home. Let the rain wash away all the pain of yesterday. I know my kingdom awaits, and they've forgiven my mistakes. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm away all the pain of yesterday. I know my kingdom awaits, and they've forgiven my mistakes. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home. Let the rain wash away all the pain of yesterday. I know my kingdom awaits, and they've forgiven my mistakes. I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming home, I'm coming home. Tell the world I'm coming.
You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you.
Pardon the way that I stare. Just no one else can compare. The sight of you makes me weak. I have no words left to speak.
You're just too good to be true. Can't take my eyes off of you. Da na da na da 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 na 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 na. I love you, baby, and if it's quite all right, I need you, baby,
to hold me through the night. I need you, baby, trust in me when I say,
oh, pretty baby,
na 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 na.
Oh, pretty baby, na 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 na. Oh, pretty baby, trust in me when I say, or something.
No, no, no,
baby, na 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 na, baby, na 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 na, baby, na 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 na. You're just too good to be true.
Thank you.